All right. Yeah, that was. I get touched every time I see that. You know, millions of people around the world are celebrating Easter, the resurrection, and that's wonderful. But for a lot of people, the celebration is going to end after the preacher says amen, after the last ham sandwich is eaten, the last $75 buffet is paid for. I mean, that's about 10 years ago, last time I went to an Easter buffet. I'm like, I'm spending $65 for some eggs. I had to wait all day and then, anyway. But for many people, the celebration is going to end when the sermon's over, when all the festivities, and then people are going to go into their next week, and it's going to be as normal as it was before the celebration. That is not the will of God. I said it in prayer. The resurrection is not just a historical fact. It is something that God wanted us to experience in a personal way every day. The Bible said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Paul said, if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, then our faith is in vain. We couldn't believe it. Why? It's in vain. But because he was raised from the dead, that was a clear sign that he was totally justified and paid the penalty and the ransom that all of us should have paid. And that God said, approved, it's good. And the Bible tells us that if Christ be raised from the dead, we've been raised up to sit together with him. But not only that, in Romans chapter 8, verse 11, he says that the same spirit that raised Jesus up from the dead now, he's not out there somewhere. He now makes his home in us. You didn't hear me. He makes his home. That same resurrection, same power that caused something that was dead to come back alive is now living in us. The same power that can take something that's wrong and make it right is now living in us. That's why we can overcome stuff. The Bible said we're more than what? Because of that resurrection power that's in us. Conquerors mean I'm confronted with some things are happening, but it doesn't matter what it is, I'm more than a conqueror. I don't just conquer it, I'm more than conqueror. He said he always causes us to what? So I just got to stand there long enough, throw enough blows, and I will triumph. But that's because of this resurrection power that's in us. When you receive Jesus, he didn't just come in and hitchhike a ride through the rest of your life. He came in and he deposited something that's supernatural that you can't get anywhere else. I said he deposited something you can't get anywhere else. What? He said, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. What's new? My waistline didn't change. My skin color didn't change. What became new? Something on the inside of me called resurrection power. And that's why, you know, I don't have to go to a detox center. I can call on the name of Jesus and be detoxed. Yeah. That's why I can go to bed sick and wake up totally healed. I'm telling Deb, I said, baby, I remember when I had these allergies. Oh my God. Madison, nothing worked. I had these allergies. It was so bad. And I said, I got to know that God is a healer. I mean, it was so bad. It was what?
So bad.
Yeah. It was so bad. I mean, I had to carry handkerchiefs and all them drugs, I don't know what they were. And I remember, it was just so bad. It was what?
So bad.
But one day, one night, I went to bed, sick as a dog, woke up, totally healed. That was probably, I don't know, 20 years. Went to bed totally sick, John. Woke up totally healed. God did it. What happened? The resurrection power of God did that. Went to the doctor. I mean, I had sleep apnea. You know, my insurance company they did cancel me. I had to fight that thing, man. I'm like, look, I need this insurance. And then they wanted, well, you're going to charge me something crazy. I say, doc, listen, I need to get another sleep test. And he said, okay. And so I said, I need about 4 months, though. He said, okay. I went down there 4 months. They test me like the doctor said, I don't know if I've ever seen a reversal like this. I said, you probably hadn't. But I got a God who deals with sleep apnea too. Totally healed. What happened? That's the resurrection power of God. So I want to talk to you about it because I think what happens is everybody knows Jesus died on the cross. Everybody know he was buried and went and was in the grave for 3 days. Wasn't he in there 3 days? Okay. And then on the third day, he rose again. Didn't he rise again? Yeah. See, everybody knows that. But I think what a lot of people don't know is that he didn't just rise for himself. What a lot of people don't know is that God is saying, this same power now, you can exercise it and you can live it every day. And you can conquer whatever trying to kill your dream, kill your marriage, kill your family, kill your life, destroy you. The devil comes to steal, kill, and what? And so that power, whatever trying to take you out, whatever trying to bury you, he said, this power. See, that's why, the devil would love for us to get caught up in the Easter bunnies and the colored eggs and the buffets. He would love for that. He would love to get you upset because you can't buy a pink shirt like Mike. Yeah. He would love. But we're going to talk about this power because what you just saw was a snapshot of the power of God that can help. So I got a couple takeaways from that. So Maureen, you're going to help me preach today. Okay, I want you to go, let's read the scripture. Go to Philippians chapter 3, please. And, you know, I typically don't preach very long on Easter. Because I know y'all got to go to the buffet. I wouldn't go, it's to the line too long on Easter, man. I'd be too hungry to be waiting no hour, 45 minutes. It ain't that good. Okay. Now, I'm going to say some things that's going to be a little in your face, but it's good. It's because it's the Bible. But I want to say that, you know, when God touched my life, I was just an average cat. I was an average guy, and I had an entertainment mindset. What was that? I would spend a great deal of time, you know, like a lot of people, I would spend a great deal of time admiring and watching other people live their dream. I was a sports addict. I would spend hours on hours watching sports. And then I would go and read, because, you know, I want to be able to be in the conversation at work. So I would go read all the stats, so I can be in the conversation, you know, for a little longer. And one day, I'll never forget to see, not this power working in me now. And I felt like I heard God say, why are you spending all this time watching somebody else live their dream? They got theirs. When are you going to start living your dream? I was a spectator. And see, there's some of you in here today. You got gifts and talents. You know what God wants you to do. And you getting impressed looking at other people live their dream. Woo! And you're happy. And you're so excited that you can talk about it. You know, I know. You know. I use these illustrations in the morning. I think LeBron James got like 2 million fans following him. And so there's people like that. You don't know LeBron. You don't know LeBron. You know you don't know him. But you know what he likes to eat. You know how many cars he got? You know what kind of, what kind of barber he got? You know all of that. You all up in his dream. And you're spending all the time watching somebody live their dream. It's time for you to get off the sideline, baby. It's time for you to take this power God has given you. You don't need to be impressed with him. You don't need to be impressed with anybody. I'm just talking about, you know, I like LeBron. I'm from Cleveland, dude. I'm near Cleveland. I'm a Cav dude. But I don't have no jersey, and my brothers, they be having the jersey, put the little head on, and they got all, if they go to the game, they like, I'm like, I can't go with y'all. I can't go to the game with y'all. Y'all be like, you know, they have all the stuff on, leather jacket with all the, you don't need to be impressed. Okay, you got to come back quick. You got to come back quick when I make the transition. Okay. You don't have to be impressed with anybody. God put something in you that's unique, that nobody else has. And it's a shame. Why would you spend hours on hours? They got theirs. That's what he would tell them. They got theirs. You don't have yours. And you keep watching them, you'll never have yours. And you ain't paid to be a fan. Yeah, and so I wanna talk to you about living your dream now. Well, that's what we just came out of a series. But this power God's given us, he's in, the Bible said the thief comes what? To steal, to kill, and destroy. If he can distract you watching somebody else, you'll never fulfill what God put in your life. So, Philippians chapter. Hallelujah. I mean, you can go home and watch a game today if you want to.
Well, I ain't watching nothing, man. Okay.
You know your wife been telling you anyway. Why you gotta sit there and watch all them games? Don't say nothing. Look on the screen. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. I'm reading out an amplified version. But my determined purpose is, this is Paul speaking, that I may know him. And that I may progressively become more deeply, listen to this, and intimately acquainted with him. What does that look like, Paul? Perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly. Good God Almighty. This ain't somebody to quit, just quit after Sunday school right here. So that I may, in the same way, come to know the power outflowing from his resurrection. Now, I want to stop right there. Now, Paul was one of the most learned guys at the time that this was written, and even before it was written. But Paul said, my aim is not to know about him. I want to know him. See, going back to the fan thing, there's people that know so much about an actor or professional player or something. They know all of their business. They go all of their business. And the way they talked about it, you would think that they go have lunch with them every now and then. You would think that they knew them. But no, they know about them. There's too many people, even Christians, that just knows about Jesus. Paul said, I don't just want to be a Christian that knows where to find Romans 3:16. I don't want to just know, say all the books of the Bible without taking a second breath. You know, I want Bible band. Well, that's wonderful. That's good. But do you know him? Well, my parents taught me. I understand all of that. And that's a good thought. But, no, Jesus is good, right? When is he good?
All the time.
And he don't mind you coming for the fish and the loaves sometime. But at some point, he's going to say, we need to talk about relationship. Yes. Yes. We need to talk about relationship. Why? Why is he? Because he said, I'm putting something in you that can trump whatever life or the enemy or anything else throws at you.
That's right. Show you right.
And, you know, he said, I want to know you and the power of this resurrection. So Paul understood, God, Jesus, you gave me something. You moved in me. See, Paul understood that life could get messy. He understood that life can start spinning and taking a spinning and just going down and down and from the left, from the right. All he understood, life can be hard. He understood life has full of surprises. He understood that. He said, Jesus, I saw what you went through. I need the power of your all this education I got, all the training I got from Gamaliel, and all of this. This does not do anything for this. So I need to know you and the power of your resurrection. That's what God has given us. That's what Easter is all about. It's about changing, and it's about rising, being able to rise above whatever comes at us. That's part of what you saw on that tape, on the video. And I love what she said. She says, when all this happened, she said, I walked away from God. She said, I knew better, but I walked away from God. There's some of you in here today. You know better, but you walked away from God. You know about God, and you feel good about that. But see, you can have knowledge without intimacy. You know what the scripture says. You know how to articulate an argument and feel good about it after it's over. But you know you don't have any intimacy with God. Y'all still love me? It's going to get better. Because I want you to win. We got to win. We're living in a world right now, and if you haven't seen it, you just haven't been paying attention. I hate church game. I hate all the crap, all the nonsense, all the stuff. I'm going to church where we can't get to the power of God to see this stuff ought to be happening all the time. Okay, one of the things that I said I'm going to talk about. One of the things that really impressed me. Y'all notice she talked about a crazy lady. A crazy lady that came and told her about Jesus. You know what I like about that? That the crazy lady told her. So a lot of us are so concerned about, we act like we need somebody's acceptance. So their opinion of us bothers us. So this lady, she said, I know you may find me a little cray cray right now, but I need to. You don't need. See. She didn't need sympathy at that moment. You know what she needed? She needed some power. That Tanessa, stand up, Tanessa. You and I had the Cray Cray stand up in the first service. That's the other Cray Cray right there. Thank you. Now, did you, when you went in and challenged her like that, did you know her? First time meeting her. And you going to get up in her grill like that? You were what? You were a little nicer than she said. Okay, well, that's the way she heard it. Okay, but here's the deal. Here's the deal. I thank God. I was so proud as a pastor. I was so proud of Ilana and Tanessa because this, the people, how can the church don't grow and all that? See, this is what discipleship is. This is what discipleship is. We equip for the work. Pastor and Sister Deb didn't go down there. Some cray crays went. And they didn't care what she thought. They let, look, this baby's life is on the line. And so what happens is, and see, that's what this resurrection power is all about. It's not for us to sit around and talk about this one, talk about that one. What's going on with that? God says, no, this power is for you, but it's also to flow through you. It's God who that work in us to will and to do his own good pleasure. So I was so proud. I'm like, see, this is what I'm talking about. What do you mean? Well, this is the way it's supposed to work. And a lot of people, and a lot of saints, that's what I'm saying, a lot of saints, they don't really know him. They know about him. See, when you know him, you can walk into a hospital room. We did that. We did that. The doctor walked out there. We was in the ICU, and they said we can't do nothing else. We said give us a room. They was in the, that person was in the first service. Does that always happen? Nope. It hadn't always happened. Wait, I prayed for folks, and they went to be with Jesus. I ain't gonna quit praying for folks to sick. We've had, well, I know we had that one. We had a couple of people. They said, well, you know, there's nothing else we can do. Well, we know somebody who can do something. So I want to challenge you. Is your life making a difference? This resurrection power, are you using it on one another? Are you using it to make a difference in the lives of people? That's one of the reasons. It doesn't work just for you, but it works and it becomes effectual when you're like, God, where and who? So like I said, there's people, some of y'all been in church for all of your life. And that's good. But the danger of it is, do I just know about him? Am I pressing myself to be able to talk about him? Or can I go to somebody and demonstrate him? And I'm not, it's not a put down, but you need to check yourself. You need to evaluate yourself and say, okay, you know what? I see it. That's why he gave it to us. I like the fact that she said, well, she came and she brought me a CD. My pastor preached Healing the Miracles here. See, you don't have to know all the answers. Give them to somebody that knows a little more than you. I remember Lynn told me when she first came to life, somebody had handed her a tape. I got about 18, 19 years ago. On living worry-free. Somebody ministered to her. We give the CDs away. I think we give them away then. We give them away. And you would think people would take hundreds of them. Well, you can only take one. But I'm trying to get us in the mindset. We just like, we come, you know, this is not a put down. I'm talking about the resurrection power. And why stuff don't work the way, you know, We gotta get a heart. God help me take this power to somebody. I guess she's just like, oh, pastor just preached on that. Let me take a tape down there. Look, he'll tell you. I don't know all that, but he'll tell you. And then what happened? Here she comes over here. Gives her life to the Lord. Other people in the family give their life to the Lord. And now, and you heard her talking. You can tell she's in that word. You can tell she ain't just you know coming out of the Cracker Jack box. What are you saying, Pastor? This is how you build the kingdom and get the saints. And get the saints out of the huddle. Okay, I want you to run down. You gonna go down there? Okay, you gonna go over there? Yeah. What Philippians 2 said? Yeah, it says that. What is it? Okay, it says that. Okay, God is good. Yes, I know God is good. Okay. Wouldn't it be funny if you're watching football and then, yeah, on two. Okay, all right, on two. Okay, yeah. They stayed in the huddle? That's what a lot of people that got the power. That's what a lot of people got the power do. That's not us. Hallelujah. So, Paul knew life would get messy. He said, no, I want to know him. I want to know the power of his resurrection. He understood past hurts. You can get stuck in past hurts. You can get stuck in loneliness. You can get stuck in dead relationships, stuck in debt, stuck in depression, stuck in lack of purpose. Jesus died and gave us all of that. But there's a lot of people that never experience the power of his resurrection. And that's what Paul is saying. I want to experience the new life of this resurrection. Hallelujah. So the resurrection is all about coming alive. It's all about rising above. Now, she says she walked away from God, but isn't it awesome that God didn't walk away from her? See, God's goodness and mercy follows you all the days of your life. Now, there's an accuser of the brethren that would tell you, oh, you messed up real bad. God can't even fix that. But those of you that are sitting here today, and you may be in church, but church may not be in you. And I just feel strongly about this today. That's why I said, I'm going to say some things, but, it's Bible. And I know how it can be. With anything, you can be so close to it that you're not acquainted with it. God wants us. See, we're all he has in the earth. God works through people. And he equips us. And one of the reasons some people, they're bogged down with issues is because they're trying to solve everything themselves. And God said, I gave you power for that. So I want to encourage you today, come back to God. Not just come back to God, come back and tap into this resurrection power. You owe it to Jesus. You owe it to yourself. Don't you let anything. He said, sin shall have no dominion. Don't let anything. Don't even let coffee dominate you. Oh, child, I got to get me a cup of coffee. I just got to have me a coffee. Well, coffee is not sin. It's not bad. The Bible says you drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt you. But don't let anything dominate you to the point. You get that little caffeine headache, Jesus. It'll take you a leave or whatever they call that stuff. And get going. Okay, now I'm gonna go back to when Alana came to her. See, there's people in our world, there's people all around us. And they look like on the outside they got it all together. There's people all around the way we work with them, sometimes we live with them, but and it looked like, so I look at y'all, y'all looking so beautiful, so handsome. I know you ain't got it all together, because I ain't got it all together. And I'm up here. It's the truth, we're human. I was praying. I prayed yesterday, man. I just praying. I got lost in Jesus yesterday. I was just praying, and God said, the Bible says, when you stand praying, you got to forgive. That's right. I said, I didn't forgive. I thought I forgave them. When you stand praying, forgive. In the Bible, he'll check you. See, you can. Can I talk to y'all? Can I talk to y'all? See, you can convince yourself. Oh, yeah, I let that go. Oh, yeah, in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, I let that go. I'm good. If you give the Holy Ghost half a second, he'll just wipe your clock clean. Won't he? But, okay, bro, I'm going to come over here and talk to you, man. But no. See, but that's good because he understands. He knows if you don't get that out the way, this resurrection power can't flow. It's not a put down. Go on and forget. Listen, ain't nobody on this planet worth holding something against. Nobody. Let it go. Just start praying. Father, I forgive everybody. I forgive. Just cover everything. I forgive. I get a man down there to sorrow. He threw the change at me. I forgive him, no. And he would check because. He doesn't want stuff bogged up and dammed up in your life. He wants this resurrection power to flow. So there are people all around us. And I just want to, there's people all around us. And it looks like they got everything together. But inside their heart is unraveling. Inside their heart is bleeding. inside, they're like, they feel like old gutted salmon. And God has a way of letting you know, okay, you know what? Being nice, I can't be nice right now. Like I said, she didn't need sympathy. She needed power. And so, and sometimes, I don't know what happened to a lot of the saints, we got sissified or something, and we don't want to tell people the truth. We want to tell them what we think they want to hear, and that doesn't serve anything. But God says, there's people, go for it. That's why I was so proud of them. I was so proud of them. So proud of them. And that's people God putting on your heart. And he going to put on your heart today. You are a change agent for God. Father, in Jesus' name, I ask you to reveal to everyone here that cares who and what to say. People's lives in the balance. They're both ready to cut this thing off, to just pull the plug on their lives. And we can't be like, well, praise the Lord, 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 what? No, you know what I mean? We got this Christian. I sound like I'm fussing, don't I? A little bit. Okay. All right. Let me slow down. I want this thing. We got this power. We got this power. I'm just trying to help you see it. Okay. All right. Now, I want to cover a couple areas. Well, one of the area. And then I'll be done. I won't be fussing no more. But it touches my heart. It touches my heart. Because, see, my vision is, and I've committed my life to teaching people the Word of God to where it makes a positive change in their everyday life. The Bible calls it being transformed into the image of Jesus. Transformed. And so that's what I've committed to. And so I believe everybody is supposed to be like that. And what would happen if this many people would buy into that? What would happen if... Because, you know, a lot of times what we call church growth is just people leaving this place, going over here, and leaving there, going over here. And we're like, oh, look what God is doing. Nice. Okay. Anyway, that's a whole other subject. But what about people that's like, man, look at this. Yeah. I know John 3:16 today. Tomorrow I know John 3:16 and 1 John 3:8. And then now my children see, whoa. This is how we live. What is the difference? It's this power that Jesus gave us. It's this power that he brought into our lives. It's this power. What is it? It's this power. It's for real. It's real. Okay. Now, there was another thing that kind of stuck out with me, and like I said, I've been thinking about this. What that testimony told me is how life can change really quick. And I know we all know that, but sometimes we don't think about that. Life can change quick. And sometimes we live like we got 100 more years instead of just taking it one day at a time. And then living in the moment to where, okay, this is the love of my life right here. But in the moment where I stay in that moment, girl, they ain't none like you in all the earth. And if we're not careful, one of the tricks that the enemy does, the Bible says he comes to steal, kill, and what else?
Destroy.
One of his sneakiest tricks is to get us to take the people that are valuable in our lives for granted. The people that love us, support us, there for us. One of his sneakiest tricks is to devalue them to where they become common. I'm gonna do a series on the familiarity. This is a little piece of where it's coming out of. And how you ever have a little kid, you get them a toy, and first couple of days, oh my God, they're sleeping with it and everything. After about 2 weeks, they leave it outside. The trash man runs over it. You know what? It became common. We do relationships like that. Sometimes it becomes common to where now we just throw it away and discard it. And that's a trick of the enemy. And so sometimes we can get so common with our salvation, like knowing about it, that we forget what it's like to be lost. I have to stand and depend on the prayers of the saints and depend on the prayer and the power of God. And so I wanted to say this. I said it this morning, how, you know, let me start with the children. We have children in here. Children, listen, don't ever allow your parents to become so common to you that you disregard their input in your life. Don't ever allow you don't understand everything, but don't ever allow what's valuable. They have a, listen, if Joe didn't have a mama connected to God and knew how to move into the things of God. There's some things that, well, maybe she can't buy you the newest Jordans. But they're the value that a lot of times we allow them to become so common that we even think they're foolish. And parents, don't even let them go there. Snatch them when they start talking like that. Because they need to understand. And it happens. But watch this. Parents, don't let your children become so common. One of the things the devil would do, see that little one, you know, we got a little one around now, and that little one that brought great joy to you. You remember in the delivery room, you cried. Oh my God, that looks just like his granddaddy right there. Oh, look at that. What he'll do is he'll make it become so common now you don't have time for him. And now somebody else is putting something inside of them to totally separate them from you. That's one of his tricks. And so we want to, I thought about all of that in there because life can happen so fast. So every day, I need to look at John. Well, he's on the other side of the country. But every day, hey, you know, we can text now. I know Deb didn't start texting until he went away to school. Now you can't keep up that thing. Okay, all right. But, you know, all y'all that got your child still up under your roof and you still got some contact with them, every day, sow some seeds of love. Don't take them for granted. Just because they're sitting at your table now, listen, in a few years, they're going to be at somebody else's table. Yeah, and so life happens so fast. But one of the things that I told you I was going to preach from this testimony, but one of the things that would diminish the power of God and the input in their life is to reduce them down to something that's not important to me anymore. And chasing a career or something. Well, Pastor, what's it got to do with Easter? That's what I'm saying. Yeah, resurrected power. What's going to help me raise this child? What's going to help me stay married and happy married? Not just enduring it because I'm the pastor. We get divorced, everybody going to go crazy. No, I'm talking about resurrection power that can, when there is an issue, it can resolve it. And we go straight to the word. Why? And stay on the word. Why? Until this resurrection power is loose in our life. And then it gets loose in your family. Then it gets loose in your home. And it gets loose. It becomes, this is how we live. People come up to your house and say, man, there's something different about this house. Why do the kids always want to come over here? Send them home. We do that all the time. Why do the kids want to stay over here? I don't want all the kids over here. Well, there's something they sense. That's what this is all about. Why do you think there's so many, you know, okay, that sounds like fussing too. I ain't going to say that. Are y'all okay? All right. So, his goal is to take what is most precious to you and turn it into something totally common where you don't value it anymore. And so, you know, I've seen it happen. You know, people used to really value church and sitting under the word of God. And the devil has called people to make it common to where if I get it, fine. If I don't get it, fine. And that diminishes and that cuts into the power of God. Because you may not have a situation like that, but you're going to have some situation. And you don't want to wait until the situation. You want to have this thing already working when you just like, okay, I got something I need to do today. And you just deal with it and just keep it moving. That's what he intended for all of us to walk in. Hallelujah. And then I need you to be able to speak into my life. Because, see, I'm not always, no, she wasn't always strong enough to do that. That's why them crazy ladies. That's why you need some crazy ladies. No, really. That's why you need some crazy lady. That's why you have to, and that's why the Bible talks over and over about who you're tracking with. Like, who you're hanging with. You need somebody with some faith and power, and you need somebody that's going to tell you the naked truth, and you need somebody to tell you truth, even though you don't understand. You got to like, okay, I trust you. All right. Hallelujah. All right. So we're gonna get rid of that entertainment mindset. If we're going to go start flowing in this power. Now, I want to close with this scripture. Go to Romans 5:17. Thank you, Jesus. God wants you to know something. What is that, Pastor? That you do matter to him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Everybody say reconnect. I want you to reconnect to Jesus in a way. Even if you're there. I mean, I've been stirred even listening to myself. To reconnect. Not what Jesus came to reconnect us back to the Father, because Adam messed up and there was a separation. And Jesus came to reconnect us, reestablish us, and restore us.
That's right.
I want you to be restored to the power of God. Sometimes the longer you're in it, you know, you kind of like, okay, I got it. And, you know, the Bible says we're to be renewed day by day and going from glory to glory. And I want you to get this, man. I want you to, starting with your family, reconnect with not only with God, but reconnect with your children, reconnect with your parents, reconnect with your, some of y'all need to reconnect with your church. Some of y'all used to love me. And then like, oh, he all right. He all right. Ken. Yeah, Ken is all right. But it's true. We start. That Lenny like, it ain't me. It ain't me. It ain't me. You don't even know me like that. Oh, it was the Red Bull last week, wasn't it? Yeah. Where the Red Bull at? I apologize for sounding like I was fussing a minute ago. So sounding like I was. I apologize for that. But I guess my passion is, you know, we don't have a whole lot of time. We live in a crazy world. And I was telling the first crew, you know, that, you know, it seemed like we forgot 9/11. It seemed like we forgot about that. That kind of stuff gonna be happening on a regular basis. And we're gonna need the Sullivan Arena to get folk, because folk can be coming to church then. But that's the world we live in. And if we're not careful, you're like, well, listen, I heard something happened in Pakistan this morning. Somebody was telling me. 50 people? Yeah. You know, shoot. And, okay, well, I'm over here. But, yeah, but if you're not careful, the spirit of fear will get on you. Oh, no, I'm not going to Israel now. I ain't going over there. I'm going to go to Omaha for vacation now. I ain't going. You know, and the spirit of fear hits you. And you're like, I ain't going to the airport. I'm not going to the ball game. And well, you know what? When you know Jesus and the power of the resurrection, you can't lose. If something happened to me, I ain't going to be. Y'all might be like, oh, my God. I'm going to be like happy. And I guarantee you, I ain't going to say, can I go back? I already know that. All the hell we got to deal with down here. I ain't trying to come back to this. No, man. I'm winning, but I ain't trying to go back. I ain't trying to come back. I don't need no stress. The power of the resurrection can fix anything. The resurrection changes everything. The reason why people sit in deep depression and deep is the power of the resurrection hadn't been able to manifest. He's there if you're born again, but it's a matter of loosening him. Because what happened? Some things are being clogged up with all kind of stuff. Amen. So he says here in Romans chapter 5, verse 17, if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, hallelujah, will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. The object is because of the abundance of grace. Now that grace is everything that God does for you independent of you. Part of that is that power he gives us. That's the hallelujah. That's why we don't check out when something happens. We're like, oh, we remember. I remember Lynn preached that message. Don't panic. Remember. Remember what? Remember who's in you. Remember what God has given you. Remember what's alive in you. Remember what he said it can do for you. Now that's the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. He said that person would do what in life? Reign. Everybody in here. I know there's all kind of stuff going on. Everybody in here can reign and dominate their life and situation. The grace of God is more powerful than anything else that can even come at you. The grace of God and the gift of righteousness. That means the gift of righteousness is where God gives me this gift. I don't earn it. I can't pay for it. But it says that when I receive it, I can. Only way I can get it is to receive it. I can't buy it. I can't give enough offerings. I can't be good enough. Only way I can get it is to what? Receive it. And he says, when you receive it, it's as if you never did anything wrong. In fact, I see you through the blood, and I see you just like I see Jesus. I'm accepted in the beloved. Other folks' opinion about me doesn't matter because I don't need their acceptance. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to upgrade my life. And even with what we talked about today, I'm going to be mindful that Jesus didn't die in vain. He died to give me something. That's why he said the works that I do shall you do also. Why? I got that same power in me. I got the same thing he had. That's why they want to water us down with the Easter bunny and the sales and the buffet. Now what buying electronics got to do with Easter? Everybody got a sale. But we're Easter people. What do you mean by that? We understand what Easter's all about. Well, Pastor, I'm just going through too much. Do you ever think about why they call the Friday before the resurrection Good Friday? What's so good about that? Suffered, tortured, killed. What was so good about that? And we call it what? Good Friday. What was so good about that? We call it Good Friday. Now, this is just friendly-ology. That means I might be making this up.
I didn't get this from one of them thick books I be reading. Well,
it's Good Friday because of what that Friday produced on Sunday. So I'm not talking about you're going to pray today and everything change. You're going to have to go through Saturday to get to Sunday. There's going to be some hell on your way to heaven. But it's not a problem. Okay. But on Sunday, you're going to get up. On Sunday, you're going to rise again. Everything you're going through right now, that's just your Friday. There was some old preachers, them black preachers used to preach called Sundays are coming. Sundays are coming. What I mean, all that hell you're going through on Friday, and you had to wake up Saturday to go through it. But hey, guess what? When you wake up Sunday, come in, oh. So we don't sweat the Friday and the Saturday. We don't like it, but we don't sweat it. Because we know Sunday's coming. This Sunday going to come for some of y'all right now. There's some of you in here right now. You and your Friday, you've been in Friday, you've been in a perpetual Friday. It's been Friday for a long time. It's been Friday for a long time. And God's like, it's ready, it's time for your Sunday. Those of you that are away from God, today is your day to come back. I love you so much. And I know I run the risk of being misunderstood a lot of time. But one thing I think cannot be disputed, I love God. I love God, and I love God's people, and I'm going to tell you what you need, because we're going to all stand before him, and I don't want to be guilty of not letting you know how much God says you matter to him. I said you matter to him. Your life matters to him. He's touched with the feeling of your infirmities. He knows where you hurt the most, and he wants to heal you. I want to pray. And we're going to release the power of God. But then I want you, it's time for you to step up and say, okay. Now, I'm only talking to those who are tired. Just tired. Tired of maybe the yo-yo effect, or tired of, man, I don't even know. I came because it's Easter. I just came because it's Easter. I don't believe none of that. I'm talking to you. I want you to believe. You're going to believe today. Father, I pray for people that are listening to me. I pray for everyone here and those who will hear this recording. My prayer is that not one person will allow anything to distract them regarding their life. We all are going to stand before God individually. But God has brought you. I don't believe you're here by accident. I don't believe you're here just because it's the Easter Sunday. I believe God brought you here to say, hey, your life matters. It's going to be different this time. Listen, you can do this. Now you have a little more information maybe you didn't have before, and it makes all the difference in the world. I want to talk to those of you who maybe you prayed and you come to know Jesus, but like she said, you walked away from it. Jesus didn't leave you. You walked away from him. And he said, listen, goodness and mercy is still following you, but you have to respond. God's like, I'm giving you this gift. You have to receive it. If you don't receive it, I'll still be here whenever you're ready. But you don't know, tomorrow is not promised for you. Today is your day. If you walked away from God, I ask you to come back to God today. I'm asking you to rededicate your life to God today. Don't take a chance on a chance. Dedicate your life to him today. Those of you that you've never really committed your life to God, and this is like, wow. I hear what you're saying. I don't understand it, but something inside of me is telling me this is the right thing. See, that's the spirit. That's what God deals with you in your spirit. Your spirit, soul, and body. Everybody has one. And God is pulling for you. The devil wants you. I'm asking you to choose life today. He said, I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life that you and it affects your family. You and your seed shall live. God has plans for you. None of them includes defeat. But you have to make that decision today. I've seen thousands of people make this decision. I've seen some run with God all the rest of their days. I've seen some run just a while and decide to do something else. But I'm still encouraged to see the life of God manifest in his people. Today is your day. That testimony, that video testimony, was a game changer to stir your heart, to stir your faith, to make you think about something. But now it's up to you to decide. In the name of Jesus, I cancel out every plot and scheme of the enemy. I cancel out everything that he would try to do, that you cannot block or hinder the people of God from making decisions for Jesus today. Father, I thank you now that you're dealing with the people and they respond accordingly. Thank you for opening our eyes today. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you say, Pastor, I'm ready to make a decision with my life, I want to either rededicate my life to God. And, you know, please, at this point of the service, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what people see or think. It doesn't matter. You have to divorce yourself from all that. This is your life. This is the only one you got. This is not a dress rehearsal. So I'm going to ask you to make a decision with your life today. So if you say, I want to dedicate my life to God or rededicate my life to God, or I just need to move forward in him, I want you to allow me to pray for you. I want you, if you are, acknowledge that by the uplifting of your hands. If you're ready to move forward with God and you want to change your life, rededicate your life, give your life to Jesus, whatever you want to call it, I want you to pray. I want to pray for you. Okay. If you're downstairs, you can come up. I can't see your hand. You can see my hand. I can't see your hand. You come on up. But is there anyone? Just raise your hand up high, please. We're not going to shame you. I want to pray for you, and we want to give you some information. We want to help you in your journey. Is there anyone in here this morning? Raise your hand up. If you're downstairs, come on up. Anyone? 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 Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, I don't see any hands. That tells me that you are happy with where you are. And I do want to do one other thing today after I dismiss. So let's all stand. Yeah. I trust that God spoke to your heart about something, and that, you know, that you made the decision. You know, whether you come up here in front of everybody or not, because what really matters is what you decide to do in your heart. And if you're in the car, you decide, you know what, I need to fix this in my life, go ahead and do that. But if you're here today and you've been told that you have something incurable, or maybe you've been given a death sentence that, you know, you got X amount of time to live, there's nothing else we can do, we want to pray for you before you go. Okay? So if that's you, I want you, we'll be up here for a few minutes. I want to pray for you. And we're going to believe God. You know, I've been so stirred with this that I was like, you know, I need to get on some things. And I don't know, we may shift the whole atmosphere of this church. I don't know. But we got all this power in here. It's not just me. We got people that can do this better than I can. So, all right. Let's pray, And then if that's you, I want you to come. If you believe God, not just us, but you believe God, I want you to come and let us pray for you. Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity today to share. Thank you for the inspiration. Thank you for the truth. Father, I pray and believe that this is the best Easter we've ever had, because your power, when we talk about your power manifests. That's just the way you do it. So I'm grateful and we're thankful. Now I pray that though we leave this place, we never leave your presence. I pray for the power of God to be released in every home, every business, every relationship, every child's life, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for it. And I call you blessed, and you have a powerful day. Go eat the rest of them buffalo.